Peace, family. Chauncey, aka Ukarima, Great Man of God Media, right back at you again with another GMOG Media Spotlight. All right, family, I have another heavy topic I want to talk about. This topic is dealing with why suspected white supremacists do not care about hip-hop. All right, I want you guys to listen carefully. I'm going to break some stuff down and for you guys to understand why the music industry is controlled by white people, why the music industry do not care about black music, why the music industry only wants to protect white artists, and they want to make sure white artists get all the resources that they need, and why hip-hop is despised and something, a music genre they could care less about. Once again, you know, I'm dealing with racism, white supremacy, and I'm dealing with all nine areas of activity. All right, and all nine areas of activity are economics, education, entertainment, labor, law, politics, religion, sex, and war. All right, so basically the music industry falls under the entertainment area of activity. All right, so like I said, the dominant society, aka white people, control all nine areas of activity. All right, so let's just get started. So basically the music industry, right, particularly the music industry that you know of today, consists of a system that music that is commercially available has to be charted. You know, basically, if you have a single out, you hear it on the radio, you know, the more popular the song is, it gets rated in the chart system. And that chart system is called Billboard. All right. So when you have a number one song or a top 10 song in the Billboard charts, depending on the music genre you're in, you know, you're going to get recognized. Right. So let's talk about Billboard. So Billboard charts, right, was a system developed by suspected white supremacists in the early 1930s. All right, so as you know, around that time, the 1930s, that was the year of the Jim Crow segregation era. So everything was separated by whites and blacks at the time. So black people were making music. You know, we had jazz, we had gospel, we had rhythm and blues, or actually soul at that time. I'll get to rhythm blues a little bit later, but you know, we had those particular genres of music available for black people. All right, and also, you know, like I said, things were segregated at the time around the 1930s, so much so that the Billboard charts, they categorized black music as race records. So anything pertaining to you know, quote unquote African Americans, people in the music industry, white people, would categorize black music as race records. All right, so that's anything to do with jazz, soul, gospel, comedy, things of that nature by black people. And we had our own, they developed their own separate system to chart popular black music or race records at the time. All right, and you know, the thing about the race records is the fact that a lot of the black artists back then, they pioneered a lot of the popular music you hear today. You know, you have rock and roll, you know, obviously Muddy Waters was a big contributor to rock and roll, and you know, people of that nature. A lot of people, black people, pioneered music genres and sounds back then that weren't really recognized by the mainstream or dominant society. And you had groups like, you know, the Rolling Stones that would give credit to black artists like Muddy Waters. You know, and the Rolling Stones got their name from Muddy Waters. You know, and obviously Rolling Stones is a, you know, legendary rock and roll group. But you know, the dominant society as a whole, the system as a whole, would not recognize Muddy Waters as a pioneer of rock and roll at all. So, you know, now back in, like I said, back in the 1940s or 1930s and 40s, you had race records categorized as black music, you know, predominantly for African Americans. So the term race records for Billboard, the Billboard publishing company, who back then were publishing magazines and publishing popular music, they actually started publishing race records in their magazine around the 1940s, particularly 1945 and 1949. All right. Now, from that point, a European by the name of John Wexler, who was also a person in the music industry at that time, he decided to change the term race records to a genre of music which is still known today. He changed the term race records to rhythm and blues records. All right, so rhythm and blues records was coined by a white guy. So now rhythm and blues and hip-hop are synonymous because of white supremacy. They coined that phrase. They coined the phrase rhythm and blues, and they categorize rhythm and blues with hip-hop. You can go on the Billboard charts right now and see R&B slash hip-hop categorized together. And that started back in 1999. That was first brought together. Those two genres of music brought together, they're synonymous by white people. So white people see rhythm and blues, R&B, and hip-hop as the same exact thing, even though they're totally different. But they're the same thing to white people. All right, family. So, like I said, Billboard magazine is a system developed and controlled and owned by white people. They decide what genres of music should go in their categories, things of that nature. All right. So you got to ask yourself a question, you know, Brother Chauncey, why hip-hop? Hip-hop is very popular. It's the most popular genre out right now. How can white people not like, you know, hip-hop? Well, on to the contrary, I will definitely prove to you that white people don't care about hip-hop. All right. And this is published on their own website. So back in August, there was a publication, okay, on Billboard.com. The publication was called Billboard Music Executive Survey: Top Brass Weigh In on Artists That Convey Most. All right, so I'm going to read to you this particular survey by all the white CEOs and top executives in the music industry today and what they think about the music industry today going forward. All right, so here's a particular question they were asked in the survey, right? So question number one, if you were starting a record label today, which three artists from any label would you sign? All right, so the top three artists are number three, Adele, number two, Lady Gaga, and number one, Taylor Swift. So obviously the theme is white artists, okay, European descent artists, as their top three artists that they would like to sign a record label with. And they're all in the pop genre, you know, they're popular artists. All right, so they have another question in the survey that they were asked. They said, do you root for Taylor Swift? And 70% of the vote was yes, 30% was no. All right. Another one was, if you could engineer the comeback of one artist that has fallen from the charts in the last 10 years, who would it be? And they voted Mariah Carey and John Mayer, and they were voted a tie. All right. Another question was, is the music industry fair for artists? 58% said no, and 42% said yes. All right. Now, these are white music executives, so in their mind, they're talking about the white artists. They're not thinking about black artists at all. Okay. Another question they were asked, who is the most talented executive in the music industry? And they have number two, Monty and Avery Lipman. All right. And number one, Jimmy Iovine. Okay. Another question they were asked, who should be running a music company but isn't? All right. So they chose three. They a tie between Scooter Braun, Taylor Swift, and number one is Lady Gaga. Again, all white people. All right. Another question they were asked, do you know more technology than the average 14-year-old? 38% said no, 62% said yes. All right, so they keep up on technology today, and they make sure they're, you know, 10, 20 steps ahead of the average person, especially the average melanated person. All right, so they know what they're doing, these white music executives. All right. And another question they were asked, would you give up your current job for a similar paying position at Apple or Spotify? 46% said no, 54% said yes. All right. And another question, and this is a question that is something very, it's a dagger to everybody listening. So the number one question, which is this is actually the fifth question they were asked in the survey. But this is a dagger, because this is going to let you know why suspected white supremacists do not care about hip hop. So according to this survey, they were asked a question. What genre of music do you despise the most? The top three genres of music they despise the most are pop, number three. Two, EDM, which is electronic dance music. And number one is rap. All right, so that lets you know that your favorite artists who are signed to major labels, okay, more than likely rappers or R&B singers, all right, your favorite rappers or singers who are signed to these major labels, they don't care about hip-hop, because right here, this survey, the music executive said they hate rap music. They hate it. They want it to go away immediately. You know, they want to save these white artists. Lady Gaga, Adele, Taylor Swift, they put those artists on the pedestal. No black artists, no rappers, no singers on the list whatsoever. I mean, you can still call the genre of music, which is R&B, hip hop, race records, because that's what is basically still categorized in this, you know, R&B. And R&B slash hip hop is basically a code word for race records. That's all it is. Race records, black music that they don't care about. As long as that particular genre of music can give them money based off the investment they put in those artists. And they can make a return off their investment, because at the end of the day, it's about the bottom line for them. As far as black music is concerned, as long as the hip hop genre is making some money from the return that they put in, the investment that they put in, that's all they care about. All right. You know, so much so, going forward with the music industry today, you know, you have artists, rappers like Bobby Shmurda, right, who was arrested and still in jail right now, you know, for some felonious crime. But the point is that when he was arrested, he could have been bailed out. Right, a still signed artist at the time, and when he got locked up, you know, he had a very, very popular song. I believe it was called "Hot Nigga," that was blowing up, you know, and popular song. He went to jail, and you know, people were complaining about, you know, why didn't the music executives, like, you know, like L.A. Reid, why didn't someone like L.A. Reid bail him out of jail, you know? So you gotta look at it. You gotta look at it from this perspective. And Dame Dash touched on this subject very well when he was talking with Dr. Boyce Watkins. So you gotta look at who owns and controls what, right? So Bobby Shmurda is just an artist, a rap artist, and rap is a category that the white supremacists do not care about. They despise rap music. So you have his distribution deal is with Sony, all right? So Sony, the headquarters of Sony is all the way in Japan. Okay. So you have a company that's owned and controlled by Sony, by Asians, Japanese, and the executives are based out of Europe in the United Kingdom, right? So you think a person out in Japan is going to care about somebody they probably never heard of, Bobby Shmurda? I can bet you right now that the people in Japan never heard of Bobby Shmurda. They don't even know who. All they look at is the dividends, the return on their investment. They're just, the rap artists are just a number in the system that the white supremacists develop in the music industry. That's what they are. They're just a number. All right. So, like I said, you know, Bobby Shmurda is not getting out of jail. Don't blame L.A. Reid. Okay. You can blame the system. The system controlled by white supremacists. You know, so much so, you know, anytime there is considered black progress or some sort of progress by black people, the white supremacists are going to stop that to a halt. Okay. And to prove it to you, you can go back into the early 2000s. And I'm pretty sure some of you may have heard of this story, but it's well documented. So back in the early 2000s, you had Irv Gotti. Okay. Irv Gotti and Jay Prince of Rap-A-Lot Records, they wanted to start their own black-owned record distribution company. All right. That was going to be an historical thing because that's never been done before like that on that kind of level. A record distribution company owned by black people. You know, that's something that was going to be record breaking. But again, once the white supremacists got a hold of that information, guess what? In 2003, Irv Gotti's New York offices were raided by the FBI. Okay. And that basically stopped the momentum of him creating a black-owned record distribution company from that point on. So, like I say, anytime you have some sort of progress, the white supremacists are going to stop any kind of progress you have because they want to own and control everything. All right? Own and control everything. You know, so much so, I mean, with the deals that the artists have today, you have 360 deals and you have, you know, the traditional record label deals. I'm going to play a clip of a entertainment lawyer breaking down the difference between a 360 deal and a traditional record label deal so that you can get an understanding, a better understanding of what I'm talking about. All right, here it is.
This is Ricky Berger, Burkent Legal Services, answering your questions via video blog. Today is an entertainment law question. What's the difference between a 360 deal and a traditional record company deal, a record label deal? Well, in the good old days, under a traditional record label deal, the record label only did a couple of things. They had an A&R guy to find the talent, they recorded the album, and then they distributed and publicized the album. They did nothing else, they were responsible for nothing else, and they got no share of any revenues from any of the other activities that a band or artist would undertake. And those other areas include being on tour, selling merchandise, being on TV shows, being in movies, etc. Then a 360 deal sort of came about over a course of time with legendary deals like from Madonna for $120 million to join Live Nation on a 360 basis. What does 360 mean? 360 means every part of her career or a 360 artist's career is handled by the label, okay? Good news, the label's interests and the artist's interests are completely aligned with everything that happens in the career of the artist. Perhaps the bad news is that this label, this company, may not have expertise in all the areas in which the artist is involving him or herself. The jury's out as to whether it works, but there are many success stories in 360 deals, and of course there are failures in 360 deals, but with the caveat that many bands on traditional label deals succeed and many fail. It's something to look for, and it's not something to shy away from in a negotiation if someone comes to you and wants to cut a deal with you. This is Ricky Berger, Burkent Legal Services. See you next time.
All right, so right now you have a lot of artists who are independent, right? So he just broke down the difference between traditional record label deals and 360 deals. But a lot of artists nowadays are independent. You know, they want to stay independent. And if they are, they have a lot of momentum, a lot of these major record companies, these distribution companies, they come to them with a deal or some sort of a negotiation contract and say, I'm going to pay you this much and give you some terms and things of that nature. The independent artists, they still have the power to say no. So a lot of the artists today, they just stay independent. If they decide to sign to a major, it's on their terms, which is a good thing. But at the end of the day, the record companies that come to these independent artists, especially the black independent artists, you know, they can write whatever they want on the contract. You know, they can write something that wouldn't even make sense to a black lawyer, because let me tell you something, the white supremacists can change things on the fly without you even knowing about it. So much so, all right, that you had an issue with Stevie Wonder when he signed his contract at the age of 21. He was working with a white lawyer at the time that helped him broker his deal. Lo and behold, that when he signed his contract, the actual lawyer took advantage of his blindness and basically put in the contract to have Stevie Wonder's royalties paid perpetually or forever. All right, so he had in Stevie Wonder's contract that Stevie Wonder's royalties will be paid forever to the lawyer, to the lawyer's estate. All right, and it's a Stevie Wonder up until this year to find that out. All right, so all the artists that are listening who are independent, you know, be careful what you sign. You're going to have to somehow get a non-white supremacist person, a white guy that you can trust, that can read over the contract for you and make sure all the I's are crossed and the T's and all that stuff are good, just to make sure that your contract doesn't have any kind of back holes or things of that nature before you sign your contract, you know? So just definitely be careful before you sign a major deal with these white supremacist record labels. Make sure everything's on the up and up, all right? So, you know, moving forward. Now, another thing by Billboard that came up with, they came up with the top 10 best rappers of all time, or top 10 greatest rappers of all time list. Okay, all right, so the suspected white supremacists came up with the list of the top 10 greatest rappers of all time. All right, so they got number 10 Lil Wayne, number 9 Kendrick Lamar, 8 Ghostface Killah, 7 Lauryn Hill, 6 Andre 3000, 5 Nas, 4 Rakim, 3 Eminem, 2 Jay-Z, and 1 Biggie. All right. Now, you know, any kind of these top 10 lists or any list in general is subjective. Okay, so it's really meaningless. But when you have a well-known and industry-leading system, which is Billboard, and they create these kind of lists, like top 10 greatest rappers of all time, people pay attention to that kind of stuff because of the system, which is Billboard making this list available to, you know, the world. So people pay attention to this, and when you have the younger generation growing up and they see this list, this is what they're going to see first. They're going to see, oh wow, okay, so this is what I have to do to be on a top 10 list. I have to be like these rappers, right? But, you know, it's just, like I said, it's a subjective list. But at the end of the day, you know, they left off so many artists that could have been on the top 10. You know, you could have had Ice Cube, you could have had Tupac. A lot of people complain about him not being on the top 10. You know, you could have had KRS-One. You know, you could have had Just Ice, in my opinion. So many artists, you know, that could have left out on the Big Daddy Kane comes to mind also. Just so many artists they left out. But another thing about the list, as you can see, the people who made the list are two white guys, okay? Two suspected white supremacists. All right, so another thing I want to talk about also is the fact that, you know, these artists, I consider these artists safe, all right? They didn't really go against the grain in terms of talking about the system. You know, they were borderline, like people like Kendrick Lamar. Rakim was more, you know, of a guy who was talking about, you know, consciousness. You know, things of that nature. He wasn't talking about going against the system of racism, white supremacy, or the government and things of that nature. You know, political rappers, you know, people like Paris, Immortal Technique, Dead Prez, people like that. You know, those guys, they go against the grain. And when you talk about the system of racism, white supremacy, you will be far less paid attention to. Okay, these type of artists, they always stay independent. Because, you know, major labels will, or any kind of major recognition, the white supremacists will not care about those kind of artists at all. You know, when they talk about that, those kind of categories. So, you know, at the end of the day, family, like I said, the music industry is dominated and controlled by white supremacists. All right. And I cover all 9 areas of activity. This particular area of activity is entertainment, which falls under the music industry, particularly hip hop. All right. They were able to create genres, name these genres, and put them together in their system, their chart system, such as R&B and hip hop. Before that, it was called Race Records, but you can still call it Race Records today. It's just basically black music that the white supremacists, they don't care about. All right. So whatever your favorite artist is in that particular genre of music, you know, I wish them much success, but they're fighting an uphill battle, you know, in order for, and like I said in another vlog that I posted, in order for someone to be successful, especially a black person, a melanated person in the industry of entertainment, they have to do things outside of themselves that's not natural, such as cooning, such as sucking up to white supremacists, things of that nature, just acting ignorant. To garner attention that's outside of your character, you have to do that to gain more exposure, unfortunately. That's the only time that you would get recognized by the white supremacists who control the music industry. But they still don't care about you, because at the end of the day, they care about their white artists. You know, as you can see from the Billboard Music Executive Survey that they did, you know, all white artists that are protected by them, they want to see them succeed. And the rap music genre is the genre they hate and despise the most. I mean, it can be blown up tomorrow, including the melanated people in it. They could care less about that at all. As long as they're 10 and 20 steps ahead in terms of technology, because they know that. They're 10 and 20 steps ahead of you in terms of technology and economics. They're all good. They are all good. And it's going to be business as usual for these white supremacists out here who control the music industry. And like I said before, you know, I talk about racism, white supremacy, and I talk about how to resolve systematic racism, white supremacy. To do that, we need a system of justice. And what is justice? The compensatory definition of justice is guaranteeing no person is mistreated and guaranteeing the person who needs help the most gets the most constructive help. All right, family, that's all there is to it. Appreciate the time. Make sure you guys like, share, subscribe, Gmoji Media TV. All right, I'm going to be hitting you weekly, constant updates on all 9 areas of activity that affect black people or melanated people in North America and across the world. All right, family, Once again, Chauncey, aka Ukarima, Great Man of God Media, signing out. Peace.